sorry, I want to turn it a slightly different way, but when you look at the problems the Palestinians face, it's a problem of an occupying army.
Yeah.
When you look at the problems that people in Ferguson or Baltimore or U.S. cities face, it's portrayed as sort of inhumane policing. The way we kind of deal with it is to try to make the police more humane or sensitive or something like that. What do we do to change the framework? And if we do change the framework to an occupying army, like Baldwin said, for example, what then do you do?
Mm-hmm. I mean, part of it is sort of like being able to define what the reality is. And in places like Baltimore, not all of Baltimore, but in that area of Sandtown, it is an occupying army. Right? I mean, that's the way it functions. It functions as an occupying army because there's no resources there. And so everybody justified also as, oh, it's got a high crime rate. Well, when you got 60% unemployment, I don't know why you wouldn't have a high crime rate. Right? When resources are just denied it. But again, it's sort of like how resources are denied. Are just kept out. There's a redlining effect, and people react. And I think that we need to sort of talk about it, because one thing, I remember in Washington, D.C., the police chief, Ramsey, he went over to Israel and did a training with the IDF, and all of a sudden, he decided to come back, and all the lights were going to be on the police cars all the time. And it was interesting, that first week there were so many accidents because everybody thought they were being pulled over by the police, right? But the reality, and again, it was his mantra, we're going to make our presence known. Well, that then becomes a contagion, because eventually, what does it take to make our presence known? What does it take? And so part of, we've never dealt with community policing in our country. We really don't have community policing. But you cannot also go and be trained by an occupying army and ever get to community policing, because the mentality is simply, it's a very simple mentality. You keep folk in check, you keep them off balance, you keep make sure that you are in control. And I don't know, even if we in a sense rehabilitate what we're dealing with in terms of police, I'm not sure where we go with that. I don't know if that answers your question at all. All right.
Yes.
So. Yeah, I mean, that's a really important point. I know that there's a lot of U of R students here. Rochester, you know, our Rochester Police Department is 93% lives outside of the city of Rochester. So in essence, it really is an occupying area. My question is actually moving towards the Black Solidarity Statement of Palestine. Actually, a comrade of mine is one of the co-authors, Kareem Peterson. And so I'm wondering, what does that mean? Is this a shift in the dialogue? Where do you see this statement going? It's been signed by something like 1,100 activists and authors. And what do you think that this means, and where do you think it's going?
You're talking about the document that was signed by black activists?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I'm one of the signatures on that. In fact, that was one of the framers of that. Well, I think what that's going is that we're trying to wake folk up. Because folks say the stuff is all the way over there, so why should they be bothered? Or I can tell you the old church cliche. Oh, they said there were going to be wars and rumors of wars, as if somehow that's an excuse for war to continue, right? I mean, that's one thing. Or the other thing is like, they've been fighting over there forever. So it's not a part of people's conscience. People have bought into the various myths around what is going on. So it's a part of waking it up. We got also in churches, we got some serious work to do, those who are part of churches, because even the most liberal church get caught up in fundamentalism. I was having a discussion with one of my church members, and his argument went like this as I was talking about my return from Palestine. And he raised his hand and said, Rabbi, he said, you know, he said, the way I see it is that this stuff is going on now because the Jews disobeyed God. And I'm going, okay, what do you mean by that? Right? I couldn't put my hand on it. And this was the argument. The argument was is that they were told when they entered the land that they were to kill every man, woman, child, and animal. And they did. And so now they have to deal with this today. Am my mouth dropped open. I had to pick it back up with my hand. But, you know, it was one of those circular, but people buy into this stuff. Because what, and just think about that theologically, if I can put that. His argument then, to me, would probably be, I didn't pursue it other than try to correct it, but his argument would be that God is a genocidal maniac, first of all. Number two is, he would suggest to me that God is a racist. Why would I say that? Because, in a sense, if somebody's chosen, that means that somebody else is not. And obviously, the scriptures, as they were being framed in that context, was written out of somebody's subjective experience. But then we try to apply objectivity to a subjective experience, and we end up with some clear perversion. And all I'm just trying to say here is that I fully believe, yes, I believe that we're all created, made, and have been given beauty, importance, intellect, imagination. Right? And that doesn't mean that you have to believe in God either. But we all have beauty in us. And that's, for me, that's a divine standard. I think that we're trying to do is get people to open their eyes and see what's going on. Many of them see for the first time. It's just like when we took the hip-hop artists over there, folks were just not aware. Folks had not seen it. And then folks' eyes were open because they saw it. If you go online, there's a hip-hop artist who was with us named Jasiri X, you remember that name? Mm-hmm. He lives in Pittsburgh. He's got a video on YouTube called Checkpoint, that he did that hip-hop video right after he came back. And half of that was shot with his phone as he tried to hide it from the Israeli Defense Forces. And so he put that video together and that song together. It's a very powerful one, Jasiri X. It's called Checkpoint. Anybody else? Yes?
I just wanted to say that I was with some of the others here on the delegation to the West Bank in 2011, and when we were protesting with the women in black in Jerusalem, some young Israeli women came up to me and said, why are you doing this? And I said, well, because I would like to see some justice for the Palestinians, and their response was, well, let's let them go away. But I just want to say that the reason I am so concerned is because it's, in the U.S., it's our money, and this is what the Palestinians said, it is our money that is enabling the Israeli army to carry out the suppression.
That's right. And you're absolutely correct. I mean, and the thing is that we also got to be aware of the language that is used and the narrative. Let me give you an example. Those of you who know Gaza, you know that Gaza has a complete and absolute blockade on it. Got a blockade in the water, and it's got a blockade on land. And so what has happened over the years, and this is why Egypt was such a serious place, a serious issue, was that the Gazans basically had dug tunnels into places like Egypt in order to get supplies and other things up there in terms of food and medicine, building material, et cetera, et cetera. And so, when the uprising happened in Egypt, that's why there was a need, one, to get the Muslim Brotherhood out of the way, and to basically go back on U.S. policy and recognize a military coup, right? To get control of the top. So when Gaza happened, and the media stood up there and they said, these are terror tunnels. They took that directly off of the Israeli press release, that these were terror tunnels. Well, these were survival tunnels. That's what existed. But it gave justification for Israel, in a sense, to bomb Gaza back really into the Stone Age. They made statements about Gaza that they were going to put Gaza on a diet. Yeah? Meaning that you were going to restrict the flow of food into Gaza. To punish Gaza. Why are you going to punish Gaza? Well, because Gaza has Hamas. It's either PLO or Hamas, right? So the reality is, and I'll be truthful with you, Israel likes Hamas.
It's Israel started Hamas.
Right, Israel started, but Hamas is a great pole in order to continue to carry on militarization with, because you pump them up and make this big, fierce terrorist organization so I can get bigger and bigger guns and more armaments and control the territory. So in a sense, it's again, it's that boogeyman kind of approach to it. But the fact is that Gaza is the largest open-air prison camp in the world. Movement is not free, is not easy. For example, we could not get into Gaza because we had to travel through so much military occupation in order to get there to be denied. And so you realize you're not talking about freedom. You're talking not only about occupation, but you're talking about really enslavement and control. And it's just like when United Church of Christ, and that's what church I'm a part of, we passed a resolution at our national meeting this past summer that basically called for boycott, divestment, sanctions against businesses operating in the illegal settlements or benefiting from the occupation. We voted that because there's so much that is engaged in terms of money being made that continues to expand the territory, and we know that we need to put pressure on Israel if Israel is going to respond in a just way to its own people, the Palestinian people. And it's not giving somebody something. It's basically giving people what is theirs. You know, there's a writer, Walter Brueggemann, theologian, and Walter Brueggemann asked a question in one of his books. He says, well, what is justice? And his answer is, justice is determining what belongs to whom and returning it. And the issue is, you can't have folks who can come from anywhere in the world and say, I'm Jewish and I have a right of return. But then you don't have the same standard for the Palestinian. They've been, in a sense, removed from the land. I'm having a gathering, church members with some Palestinians on the 30th. And one of the people in the group's father was a farmer in Palestine. His family was a farmer in Palestine before 1948. And when 1948 happened, the family got on an ox-drawn cart and went into Lebanon to try to escape the fight. And so he grew up in a refugee camp from the time he was 4 years old until he left the camp to try to go to school. And the fact is that he could not return home. The family left to get out of fighting, and when the fighting was over, they were told that the country no longer exists. And he spent the rest of his time in a refugee camp in Lebanon. That's the nature of the beast. I saw the hand back there. Yes, ma'am.
Well, now what do we do about this upcoming election? I mean, I have a lot of interesting pieces in this. I'm the daughter of a judge, was appointed by Reagan when Reagan was the governor. My dad was a Democrat, went after the LA Police Department in 1967 for abuse of minorities. Who did they try to destroy? My father. So I went to a boarding school. We were all shipped off to schools with a girl, his great friend, who's now, she's been at the State Department for over 30 years, mainly serving in the Middle East. So I was walking around DC with her a couple of years ago. My daughter worked for Hillary. And I said, so what's your issue with Hillary? She said, Israel. And then she said, find out about the USS Liberty.
The what?
USS Liberty. Mm-hmm. And then she served in all her whole service except for 3 years were in India. But this is really, now I'm thinking, okay, this is just interesting. There are all these pieces out there. Mm-hmm. Bernie Sanders, I mean, come on. What do we do looking at this election?
Well, I think we just have to see what happens. I mean, but one of the things that's always interesting is look how Israel becomes the litmus test. Everybody want to justify that they are the friends of Israel and they'll never turn back. Well, there's a whole lot of other places in the world. Are you a friend there? And that's what we really got to sort of begin to demand. It's not a matter of folk turning their back on those that they have been friends with, but it's a matter of, are there some other friends also? I mean, I don't just have one friend. Praise God for that. You know, but what I'm getting at is that we have become so myopic in our approach to all of these things, and not just to say that, but the other thing is that all of these folk that have lost limbs and have been killed in adventures in Iraq or adventures in Afghanistan, and it goes on and on, continually, for anybody who is sort of into international affairs, half this stuff that we're dealing with right now is a blowback to what we created. And then we send folks off to defend freedom. And I don't even know what that means any longer. When somebody says they fight for our freedom, what does that mean? Unpack it for me. Tell me, what do you think that we're fighting for? Right? Are we, you know, when we were in Iraq, we were fighting for what, the oil companies? And what I'm saying, we need to pull basically the sheets back and have an open, frank discussion about what's really going on. How can you dare have 60% unemployment in a place like Sandtown? And not to mention other places all over this country. We spend our money in armaments overseas, but we don't spend our money at home.
Look what happened to Jimmy Carter after he wrote Peace and Not Apartheid.
Right.
He had tax.
Mm-hmm. That's right. And the thing that I would say to us right now is that we gotta have the courage to speak up and to challenge, right? To keep it out there up front. I should be able to talk about Palestine. I should be able to talk about South Africa. I should be able to talk about all the other places in the world without being shut down, without being threatened, without being marginalized. The fact is that each of us, we have the responsibility to let our word be known. To tell it to your neighbor, your friend. It may disturb some folk, but some folk need to hear how insidious this racism is that continues to grip us here, not only in the United States of America, but in Palestine and Israel as well. Israel will not continue to survive. Israel will not continue to survive. That's not a threat. I just know that you cannot continue to put that kind of money in creating a society that is militarized and survives. Because eventually you're not going to be able to take care of your people, because so much money and more is going into military implements that you're unable to be a healthy society any longer. That's what I mean. Right? It's not somebody else doing something to Israel, it's actually Israel doing something to itself. And that's why our work, in a sense, to stand in solidarity with Palestinians is also a work to free Israel from the kind of madness that it's currently engaged in, and to free the U.S. to be peacemakers and not warmongers. Yes?
Going back to your point of commerce and boycott, can you offer any insights on the SodaStream situation?
Well, it's been making some inroads in terms of some stores withdrawing SodaStream from the shelves, but largely because of direct action by groups on the ground. So there's SodaStream, there's also Sabra products that we look at. So there's a number of other things that you encounter every day in your stores as well, SodaStream, right?
Go ahead. I'm coming from a question of, if SodaStream exists and people are doing business and commerce is engaging conversations, aren't those bridges to peace and understanding?
You mean if SodaStream exists?
Correct.
Well, understand, it's not necessarily a movement to bankrupt SodaStream, but to try to put on to companies like SodaStream the kind of economic power that causes them to wake up. Causes companies like that to enter into the discussion of how you make true and lasting peace and how you build a civil society. Right, that's what it's really about. It was like when we were doing the stuff of trying to withdraw the Cougar Army. You know, and I ran that big line for over 2 years in Boston. But it was a reality that, yes, we wanted the Cougar Army banned from the U.S. Why? Because that was a statement, one to the world and to South Africa, that kind of behavior is not behavior that should be accepted in civilized culture. And it began to change the way it related to the world and related to its own people because of those kinds of economic pressures that were put on it. So that's what SodaStream and all the other products are on the list in terms of boycott is about, is to change and withdraw the dollar so that you have some type of discussion about what it means to really and truly survive, and that I can't make money if somebody's suffering.
I was wondering if you have any, this is a difficult question to give a clear answer to, but I was wondering if you have a specific view of the solution you'd like to see on the ground.
Of a solution?
Yeah.
Well, as I said, two-state solution is only going to work if you dismantle all of the illegal settlements and take down the wall. People have to have free movement. I'm not saying you don't have to have a border, but you don't need to have a Berlin Wall in place. Right? And that's what the separation wall is, and that's why it meanders in that way. The other thing is that another method that can be taken is where everybody is enfranchised to vote, where everybody can participate, and not without limit, Because one of the things that I always look at is if you, student of history, right after the Civil War, when Union troops were stationed in the South and orchestrated one person, one vote. That's when we sent people to office. And then all of a sudden, as people, black folks went to office, there was a whole system of intimidation and murder, lynchings, sent folk, so that eventually they removed everybody from office and we didn't have another black person to go to Congress until Chicago in 1920s, and that was Oscar the Priest. But that was because of the everybody free in the South. And so again, you know, what I'm saying is that if you come back to a civil society, ask the question, what is a real, just civil society looks like? Do people have the vote? Are people able to participate in the public debate? Are people able to protest? Are people able to talk about what their needs are as a people, as a village, as a community, in order to survive, and it's part of the whole fabric of the nation? Then we begin to move somewhere. Yes?
So you mentioned that we should be able to talk about this situation openly, but I'm a keyboard member of Sadaka, and so I got to witness all the problem with trying to get you here, and thank you for coming.
Thank you.
But how do we get our voices heard when the other end doesn't want to hear it?
Well, you know, I mean, it was just like that example from when I'm talking about Reconstruction. And the whole example around Reconstruction was that they intimidated folks, right? And so folks did not go to the polls eventually, right? And then they passed laws to make sure that you couldn't register to vote. So all the same. So the thing is to recognize that folks are going to try to intimidate you into silence. And the issue is you got to stand up to them. When I knew that the place that I was supposed to speak at, the invitation had been withdrawn, I said to my congregation last summer, I said, I'm going anyway, whether or not I have to speak in a park or not, because the fact is I cannot let folks who intimidate win. And I cannot let people who try to threaten other folks and push them around win. And that was really my issue down in Hebron, was to know that I could not just stand there and produce some papers because, and I said because some pimply-faced white boy with a gun asked me for my papers. Right? I could not, and then to find out he was from Chicago, no, he was not going to intimidate me. He's going to kill me. And the fact is that I knew that I had a little bit more rights than Palestinians. And therefore I knew that I could stretch it just a little bit more. Because I knew that somebody who was Palestinian would immediately be shot down or beaten down for doing that. And therefore I really felt that it was up to me if I had that opportunity to stretch it, to do it, to stand up, to let folks know that I wasn't intimidated and was not afraid. And I think that's what we gotta do also. Folks gonna try to shut you down, don't allow it to happen. Folks gonna try to silence you, don't allow it to happen. Make sure you know what you're talking about, but don't allow yourself to be silenced because somebody feels that what you're talking about is an uncomfortable truth. That's what freedom of speech is all about. Right? It's to dare to speak truth even when it is inconvenient.
Sorry.
That's all right.
I was thinking about this and contemplating the question. But when you speak about freedom of speech, then you come across as just everyone's putting their opinions out there, and it's a matter of the right or wrong. And then you have people like Charlie Hebdo who put things out that are offensive, and you don't know what the balance is between those two. So how can you talk about these things without it being a freedom of speech type of situation where everyone's just coming off?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of opinions out there, right? And in the street, we say something about opinions, right? You know what I'm saying. But you know, the reality is, you've got to be studied, I believe, right? Everybody who shares opinion don't mean that they know much about the topic they're talking about. Case in point, Bill O'Reilly. Case in point, Hannity. Right? Go around down the line and talk about some of the folks who just love to hear their mouths run. And they take a half-truth and try to make it a full-truth. And that's why the distortion takes place. But you gotta be studied. Because one of the things that we gotta be interested in, and always interested in, is truly enlightening people. Now I know I get in trouble as a preacher because I'm a historian, and I always talk about history from the pulpit. And I know half my folks don't wanna hear history, right? But the fact is, I'm not called to dumb people down. God gave us this. And I'm called to challenge that. And even if you disagree with me, that's okay. That's a part of what this is all about. But we don't shut each other down, because then we come to a place together where even with our half-truths, if your half-truth meets my half-truth, then we'll have a whole truth. Right? And that's the way it works. But it's only going to happen out of dialogue with one another, out of being able to talk about the subject. And to talk about racism, because we don't like to talk about it as a country and as a world. Yeah, I hope that makes some sense. Okay. Yes.
This is a reflection. My daughter served in Peace Corps in Paraguay. Mm-hmm. And a girl was attacked right next to Kate by the son of the butcher from Kate's community. And my daughter, 6 foot tall blonde, had to be hidden with a garment 6 hours into the mountain, 6 hour walk. They didn't even speak Spanish. Never heard of Peace Corps. Didn't trust any American coming. But what I observed, I spent a month in this community, 40 families. The prejudicial nature there. This one farmer near Cates, they thought was gay. He was ostracized. Mm-hmm. I mean, I got robbed. I'm her mother. She's bringing all these things. Only 10 women would join her women's group. But I said, and it looked like Santa Barbara. It was absolutely beautiful. Mm-hmm. Animals were rejecting animals of their own kind, that if they weren't perfect. And I thought, wow. And here we are, in most basic. They cooked over campfires, no toilets. They used corn cobs as toilet paper, no running water. And I thought, wow, this is very bare bones basic. And these are the people that are trying to establish a life. Versus, you know, the police. If you have a meeting, she had to go down every week and get, you know, an agreement, because it's still very controlled by the Germans. But I thought right there, it was such an eye-opener for me, because they couldn't even come together as a community of 40 families.
You said we're out of time?
Well, this is the last question.
Okay, last question, one question.
Deal with it. How do you deal with that when you're at the big, most basic, and you already see it almost as inherent to human and animal nature to reject?
Well, one of the things, even at the basic levels, where people still are able to come together, but it takes a catalyst in order to bring people together, allow people to see a larger vision of things. I mean, I've organized in some of the poorest communities. There's always this theory that at a certain level, people are so poor and feel so disenfranchised that they have a hard time coming together. Well, I found out that's not necessarily true if you've got something that begins to create the catalyst that draws people together. Right? And that's what you have to find out in a situation like that. It's about organizing and building community. How you do that, sometimes it's a slow affair. And sometimes it's just finding out the types of things that moves people. Sometimes it's, you know, the whole liberation church thing was the idea that you went to the poor communities and people came together around this understanding of God. And then you organized to change the world from there. One more, anyone? Yes.
Okay, so today was kind of the day to be happy and to celebrate or whatever. Today is exactly. What do we have to be happy for? What do we have to celebrate?
What do you have to celebrate? The fact that you're here.
It's true.
All right. The fact that you're here, the fact that you're here, one up. I mean, I look at this crowd's pretty diverse, got something to celebrate. And that's a part of the beauty of being in a place like this. And I think that what we celebrate is also the world that we're going to build. There's this text that just pops in my mind from one of the scriptures from Paul. Paul writes his word. And it always leaves astonishing words for me. Because he said, we rejoice in our suffering. Right? I'm going, rejoice in suffering? Right? He said, we rejoice in our suffering. Because suffering brings endurance. And endurance brings character. And character brings hope. And hope does not disappoint us. And I think that's where we are. Right? We go through the process in order to get to hope. Because at the end, hope will not disappoint us. As long as we're continuing to think and organize and struggle around things, then we are engaging hope, and hope will not disappoint. And that's my hope for us, and that's my hope for our world, is that we move forth and we begin and continue to construct the world that we want to see and the world we want to live in. God bless you.
Blessing to us. I'm the convener of Christians Witnessing for Palestine, and it's just a small group of people who have been there, have witnessed, came home knowing that we had to do something, and we began bringing speakers to town to talk about this issue. Many of them are very committed Jewish activists that we have brought to Rochester, and we've developed a film series that Reverend Hagler is sort of kicking off for us, and it begins Sunday. So it's Sunday, Monday, and then the following Sunday, Monday. I feel terrible that the flyers that I would have for you are in our car, so I'm really sorry about that. But if you jot down our website, you'll find the information on the website, and it is simply witnesspalestinerochester.org. The Sunday movies are at 2 o'clock at the Little. Did I say the Little?
No.
Are at 2 o'clock, and the Monday evening are at 6:45. Each of them is followed by a question and answer period with the panelists, and so there is more yet to learn. Student ticket price is only $5. And adults, by the way, are $8. So we invite you to come and to view these four films. St. John's Fisher will have a film there on campus, also on the website, that Wednesday, October 7th, I believe. Right, Jim? Wherever Jim is. So we just invite you to come to the screenings. Or certainly to come to hear Reverend Hagler tonight at the German House. And again, we just so appreciate. If any of you would like to be on our events list, we have an email events list, and for that we just send out the notices about upcoming events. Why don't you write your name and email on the paper that each of you was given, and hand it to me. I'll be over at the door, and we'll be happy to add you to that events list. Thank you.
Journal of the hard times, tales from the dark side, evidence of the settlements on my hard drive. Man, I swear my heart died at the end of that car ride. When I saw that checkpoint, welcome to apartheid. Soldiers wear military green at the checkpoint. Automatic guns, that's machine at the checkpoint. Tables not M16s at the checkpoint. Fingers on the trigger, you get leaned at the checkpoint. Little children, grown adults and teens at the checkpoint. All your papers better be clean at the checkpoint. Gotta put your finger on the screen at the checkpoint and pray that red light turns green. green at the checkpoint. And Martin Luther King had a dream of the checkpoint. He waked with loud screams from the scenes at the checkpoint. Is Malcolm X by any means at the checkpoint? Imagine if your daily routine was the checkpoint. And Martin Luther King had a dream of the checkpoint. He waked with loud screams from the scenes at the checkpoint. Is Malcolm X by any means at the checkpoint? Imagine if your daily routine was the checkpoint. Separation walls that surround in the checkpoint. On top is barbed wire like a crown on the checkpoint. Better have your permits if you found at the checkpoint. Coming on the tower, aiming down at the checkpoint.